Thank you very much for the nice introduction, and especially to the organizing committee for inviting me and giving me the opportunity to open PASC as a clear domain scientist, namely a seismologist that I am. I'm interested in earthquakes, which are the response of huge masses of rock being loaded by plate tectonics and releasing this load in terms of shear fracture, shear cracks propagating and emanating seismic waves. I'm specifically excited about speaking at PASC because my personal research history is almost as young as the history of the PASC conference. So I've been freshly graduated attending the first PASC conference, sitting there in the audience, being very impressed by the keynote talks, big simulations, big data, and especially the fact that many different research directions are connected by scientific computing and driven by scientific computing in terms of important scientific or natural science advances, or financial science, as we will hear apparently during this conference. I have to acknowledge, or I want to acknowledge, the joint work of earth scientists and scientific computing that I'm presenting today. Both chairs are based in Munich. There's my earthquake physics team at LMU Munich, and there's a chair of scientific computing led by Professor Michael Bada at the Technical University in Munich. And the work that I'm presenting today is really a 50-50 joint effort trying to create win-win situations for both us trying to understand physics of the Earth and also for scientific computing trying to put their tools to relevant use. And also for supercomputing centers, making the machines run on scenarios which are potentially having a huge effect on society and science. I want to introduce the topic by talking a little bit about computational wave propagation and earthquake rupture. This is not quite the same. Computational wave propagation, an example is shown here, of waves propagating after the 2009 Italy L'Aquila earthquake throughout the Earth, is focusing on efficiently simulating, solving the elastic wave equation with some more or less complicated physics connected to it, specifically challenged by the complexity of our Earth. Whereas earthquake rupture is trying to look into what happens at the earthquake source. And this leads to what Dimitri mentioned being a highly nonlinear coupled problem, and what I term in the following as a multiphysics problem. Computational wave propagation is data which we have a lot of observations in form of seismograms. We can often treat the problems we want to solve as linear systems. Computational seismology has been a pioneering field and has been pioneered by HPC. So we have community codes as SPECFEM, which Dimitri is one of the core developers, which have been employing high-performance computing since a decade or more. The key activity is the calculation of synthetic seismograms in 3D Earth and solving seismic inverse problems, for which we need a lot of forward simulations. Key achievements are imaging Earth's interior, understanding the dynamics of the mantle, so what is the floating layer that moves the plates on top of it around, and tracking down energy resources. And the common approach, the most common approach to tackle these problems is a time-domain solution of space-dependent seismic wave field solved by domain decomposition. So we're splitting up the Earth or our area of interest into many small elements or grid points and discretizing the problem in space and time and solving it in the time domain. A famous quote I want to put up here is stated by Jerome Trump from Princeton University, stating that the forward problem of seismic wave propagation is solved. We still have some ongoing challenges here, tackling computational efficiency, especially when resolving high frequencies. If we want to resolve high frequencies, the waves are sensitive to small-scale structure as well, which we don't know, so there's some kind of analytical approaches how to incorporate that in models. Meshing is a huge bottleneck, especially for irregular geometries, and the need for community solutions, and that is keeping us busy. Community solutions I want to put up here because seismology is a very open field. Most of the advances we achieved is based on free data sharing of seismograms. And the same kind of community spirit is tackling also, or is leading us in computational seismology, trying to create community codes and sharing synthetic seismograms. Earthquake rupture, on the other hand, is very ill-constrained. We don't have actually any direct observations and is highly nonlinear. Earthquakes are everywhere on Earth. They're potentially disastrous as well as an invaluable source of information. We're seeing here the well-known so-called ring of fire, where a lot of earthquakes are occurring at pronounced tectonic boundaries. And while most of today's knowledge of the structure of the Earth is imaged by propagating waves from earthquakes, what happens at the earthquake source is still very much mysterious. Direct observations are difficult. we can't really drill that deep. We have laboratory experiments which are facing problems in how to scale them up to the huge scales that I will talk about a little bit later that are governing earthquake source physics. And we have a naturally limited amount of large and strongly radiating earthquakes. We do have a vast amount of information from relatively small events, but the large ones are rare, and we don't know when they happen. We know that earthquakes are the result of ruptures that somehow nucleate, grow, dynamically propagate, and terminate, in most cases along pre-existing faults. But the most useful thing a seismologist like me could do, predict earthquakes, is what we are least able to do. So since earthquake prediction is escaping us, we address this deficiency by trying to understand earthquake source physics. Recent observations of earthquakes, since we're getting more and more dense instrumentation, reveals that we're actually facing a striking variability of earthquake sources. We see effects like super shear propagation, earthquakes propagating faster than you would expect from the wave speeds of the surrounding material. We're seeing reactivation of the same faults propagating, slipping twice throughout one event. We're seeing nucleation of earthquakes sometimes with, sometimes without precursors. We're having variability of rupture styles that can be just a pulse breaking through the crust or continuously breaking cracks. We're seeing cascading and jumping between edges and fault segments. And we also see that earthquakes can propagate through locked and creeping fault sections in the same event. And I show here some new source imaging approaches from the Tohoku event in Japan, which was very well recorded. Here you would see the hypercenter being here. All of this rectangular is, is denoting the slipping or breaking, rupturing area, and in the color scale, you would see how the slips, or how the displacement propagates throughout the earthquake in this event. And you can see it's really not very linear or not very easy to understand. This is a new method based on seismic array processing called back projection, and it's basically tracking where there's high frequency radiation on the fault. Also, quite complex behavior. One aspect I just quickly want to take out of this list is so-called super shear propagation. What you would see is, and here is one example of how earthquakes look in the laboratory, I would specifically to point out the scale here, which is 10 millimeters, you would see here's your fault, which is pre-existing. You have an earthquake nucleating here, and breaking through this fault, you see your normal crack propagating, and then you have some kind of Mach cones developing here. This is similar to an airplane going supersonic and generating Mach cones in the air. This is also something earthquakes can do, and you can track that in seismograms. Seismic hazard assessment, on the other hand, is very often relying on empirical, probabilistic, and simplified, oversimplified approaches. The reliability of the seismic hazard assessment that we have in place is heavily relying on how we define seismic faulting in these models. The typical relation used in seismic hazard engineering are so-called empirical attenuation relations, which would give you here the peak ground acceleration on the y-axis and the distance to your event here. Please note that this is a log plot. This is kind of records from one earthquake, how much the ground was shaking and which distance to the event. As you will see, there's very few data close to the epicenter. We have a lot of scatter, and how this is approached is by just fitting a line through here, and where we have no data, we're just leveling it out. So this is the state of the art here. There's not much physics in there. Our approach is large-scale dynamic rupture simulations, aiming to understand on natural scale which of the complexities of the Earth system our first order influences on ground shaking and on earthquake physics. While earthquakes are in many sense unique, despite occurring in the same location, so they keep surprising us. If you're following the news, you will find that almost every major event has one or more surprises for us. We don't quite understand which physical processes are dominant and relevant at a given scale. And which of these effects can we justify to include in most often computational costly models? To realize these kind of scenarios, we need an integrated view of the multiscale physics of rock fracture, dynamic crack propagation, and emanating seismic radiation. We do this all in complex 3D geometries, and this is, however, but, or luckily, computational expenses, because we can run it on supercomputing machines. Second topic, multiphysics of dynamic rupture earthquake simulations, trying to lead you through the actual problem that we're solving. This is an example of a simulation we set up recently from the 2016 New Zealand event, which was arguably the most complex rupture observed to date, and I'll speak about that tomorrow. But now we're speaking about very simple problems. In this physics-based approach of earthquake dynamic rupture simulations, we're trying to solve dynamic earthquake propagation in nonlinear interaction with the seismic wave field. And we need some kind of model, geological structure. We need initial conditions, which are the stress acting on the fault, and the strength of that fault resisting the stress. We need a step which I identified previously as a bottleneck, which is CID, geometry, and mesh generation. We need some physics telling us when we have slip, when we have no slip, a solver. And luckily, or in the best case, we get ground motion, synthetic ground motions, and seismograms as an output. Many methods actually solve idealized problems which have been stated as community benchmarks. So one of them is put here. You see a planar fault, rectangular, not dipping, so this so-called strike slip fault, with some heterogeneous stresses acting on it. And this would be the earthquake propagating from the hypocenter and a contours of 0.5 seconds away from this breaking this fault. And here is a number of groups, and I especially want to point out the kind of methods that have been used to solve this problem in great agreement if you're comparing the synthetic seismograms and what happens on the faults. We have finite difference, finite element, spectral element, discontinuous Galerkin. We also have boundary integral methods, which I think are not listed here. However, the real world looks more something like this. This is a map of the Southern California fault structure, and you see all of these faults are banded, are curved, are intersecting, are branching. On top of that, we have to solve the problem on a multitude of spatiotemporal scales. These fault geometries can span hundreds of kilometers. The frictional process zone size, this is the inherent length scale defining the resolution of our problem where the stress drops at the rupture front, can be in meters, centimeters, or even millimeter scale. The tectonic loading happens over up to 10,000 years. The rise time, the rupture duration of one earthquake is on second scale. Also, our community comes up with a lot of new and great physics, which is all thought to highly influence rupture dynamics. So that ranges from nonlinear friction loss, heterogeneities, having to include thermal pressurizations of fluids interacting with faults, fault gouge, flash heating, and all kinds of complications. And this list grows continuously. So every year we're getting new physics that would be interesting to analyze here. Few methods can actually support all modeling requirements. We are using a code called a software package called SciSol, which is a kind of a unique modeling framework, has been developed and hosted at LMU Munich over the last decade. It's based on a high-order derivative discontinuous Galerkin numerical discretization, combined with kind of an exotic time scheme called ADA. We're solving the seismic wave equation in elastic, viscoelastic, viscoplastic media on unstructured TET meshes. Our method by design permits representing complex geometry, so this is really where we see our strength, by discretizing the volume via a tetrahedral mesh. So if you're thinking about some kind of shallow intersecting subduction zone, you have to mesh, including topography. This would be much easier if you're trying to fit little triangles in that than trying to do that with hexaeders. Here's an example of a volcano simulation and how the mesh would look like for that. We're modeling heterogeneous media, elastic, viscoelastic, viscoplastic, anisotropic, especially important for understanding earthquakes because what happens around the source is not linear. Multiphysics coupling, information between elements is exchanged via numerical fluxes. This seems to be very natural for representing sharp discontinuities as an earthquake fault, so physics defined on interfaces. So our fault will be represented as a shear stress discontinuity across this fault interface, which is assigned to two elements, and we're solving for this spontaneous rupture coupling just by setting up an internal boundary condition. We're having high accuracy because our flux formulation is numerical dissipative, and which naturally suppresses unresolved or artificial high frequencies. And this is a comparison of the DG measurement taken on the fault versus a spectral element method. We can achieve high resolution, and it's easy, relatively easy to parallelize it. So it's very suitable for supercomputing centers. The numerics in a nutshell, I thought I have to put up at least once the seismic wave equation. Hopefully it's something that everybody has seen once or twice. We solve it in a velocity stress formulation. So we're having the constitutive relationships in terms of velocity and conservation of momentum. Okay, so this is just a linear hyperbolic system. We're discretizing via ADA, high-order time integration, which is coupled to DG, discontinuous Galerkin method, high-order space discretization. Our flavor of DG is modal, so we're using orthogonal basis functions. We're using the Godunov flux, which is just an exact Riemann solver to compute the upwind flux, which gives you the state at the element interfaces. If you're writing it down in a discrete form, it would look something like this. If you visualize the sparsity of these matrices, the operators look like that. Our computations are local, only neighboring elements exchange data. This is the update scheme and Kozhikov-Walewski term. So in summary, this method boils down to a lot of small matrix-matrix multiplications where the dimension of these matrices is depending on the order of the scheme. And actually, we're using about 75% of runtime computing, a lot of small dense matrix multiplications. Okay, I want to give you a short history of the software. So what we started with is what I call the geophysics version. This is written by postdocs, PhD students, and assistant professors in kind of the typical geophysics heroic coding approach, which means you take a problem, you solve it from scratch using Fortran, writing out a lot of ASCII wave fields and seismograms, and then trying to port it on relatively large in-house clusters, or in our case, the LHC, the Leibniz Supercomputing Center. Everything is easily parallelized with MPI, but we're stuck with Fortran 90 because this is what geophysicists can normally do, ASCII-based and serial I/O. In the collaboration with the scientific computing, we wanted to have an end-to-end optimization of this approach, but at the same time doing an operation at the open heart. So doing it while we're still trying to run every stage of the code and solving actual geophysics software problems. The first result that we came up in 2014 is calculating an earthquake scenario of the Landers event. This is in California, which consisted of 96 billion degrees of freedom, 200,000 time steps. Here I just show what happens on the fault without the wave field because visualization of big data is challenging. This was a Gordon Bell Prize finalist paper at a supercomputing conference in 2014. We achieved this by a hybrid MPI open MP parallelization with a customized scheduler using parallel I/O, so modern data formats. We had some kind of offload scheme for splitting up the more expensive calculations of the dynamic rupture elements and the wave propagation part. But most important, there is an implementation of assembler-level DG kernels. And all of this led to around one petaflop performance, 90% parallel efficiency from the user's perspective to 5 to 10 times faster time to solution and up to 100 times bigger problems. The main idea was to remove irrelevant entries in the matrix chain products. So a customized code generator automatically detected and exploited the sparse block patterns, and we basically do the job of the compiler manually. There's a hardware-specific manual unrolling and vectorization of all element operations, which means that for each matrix-matrix multiplication, we have customized code, which is using the libxsm backend. And this efficiently exploits, as of 2014, available hardware, reaching up to almost 8.5 or 9 petaflops on the Chinese supercomputer TND2. Today, I want to speak about the 2004 Sumatra megathrust earthquake, a geophysics and HPC challenge. This is an illustration of what happens beneath Sumatra. You see two tectonic plates colliding head-on, forcing one of them subducting, so moving, diving beneath the other one. And this is what's loading the system and is releasing a vast amount of seismic energy. The Sumatra event of 2004 was huge, was one of the biggest events ever recorded, and most importantly, it triggered a devastating tsunami, claiming more than 230,000 lives in 14 countries. There was no early warning system in place. So besides being an HPC and a geophysics challenge, this is really also about people. Earthquakes and tsunamis are to date not predictable hazards. So the challenge is really in the physics. We do not know how earthquakes begin, grow, or sometimes arrest. We also don't know when a large earthquake triggers a tsunami. So just the observation of having a magnitude 9 event in Sumatra is not enough to issue a tsunami early warning, because a tsunami triggering earthquakes have very special characteristics, which we don't know how to correlate with how the subduction system is operating. So this was an unexpected, very large earthquake. The pure dimensions are geophysics challenge for setting up a model. There was 1,500 kilometers of fault zone, which is basically crossing once through all of Europe. There was a slow rupture velocity, so we have to model a long duration of up to 10 minutes. We have a very complex geometry problem. We have non-planar intersections, we have very shallow angles where the subduction zone meets the bathymetry. And we have small pop-up fractures, which are splaying off the megathrust, which may have been crucial for tsunami generation. Each of these tectonic plates comes with its own wave speeds and requires a different discretization. An HPC challenge, the mesh that we came up with, which we have liked to have resolved, had a resolution of 400 meters on the fault of order 6 elements, 2.2 hertz wave propagation, which added up to 220 million finite elements, so 111 billion degrees of freedom. To generate this mesh, we needed to incorporate high-resolution geodata, so we actually needed to use a geoinformation server, which is fast and in parallel loading and initializing the model. and we are also paying for our capability of including such complex geometries by having highly varying element sizes. Now we have static adaptivity here, and we have all of these intersections. The idea to overcome this is local time stepping. So why not have each element run at its own time step, which is in our explicit solve limited by a CFL criterion. The theoretical speed up of doing that would be a factor of 14.3, sorry. The problem is that it's not from the numerics point of view, so DG is very natural for local time stepping, but the irregular update scheme are not well suited for modern hardware. So the partition should be done in clusters, which can be tailored then to the hardware that the problem should run on. And by doing that, we get a speed up of factor 9.9 with petascale performance. So we're sacrificing part of the theoretical speed up in favor of hardware-oriented data structures and efficient load balancing. I also want to point out that only 4% of these 220 million elements are actually holding dynamic rupture phases, but it's really crucial to include them in the optimization that we have seen. And it also highly relaxes the problem of mesh generation that we have. with this local time stepping, we actually see that the smallest elements have been updated, I think, 3 million times, whereas the largest elements have only been updated 3,000 times. So quite a difference. Algorithmic and performance improvements that have led to our production run on all of SuperMOOC phase 2, which is 86,000 cores, has been single node optimization. So we're doing some kind of matrix decomposition, just reformulating all of our numerical problems into matrix chain products, which can then be tackled by this code generation. This was a speed up of factor 2 compared to the baseline version. The clustered to local time stepping, including dynamic rupture, gives a speed up of factor 7, asynchronous input and output, which is basically overlapping computation with communication, get another, okay, basically for free. So we had to write 13 terabyte of data for checkpointing and 3 terabyte of data for visualization and post-processing. So this is the science part here. Since we're anyway reserving one core for communication, this core was also doing the asynchronous input-output, and basically this was coming then for free. So in total, we get a speed up of factor 13.6. I show here strong scaling on SuperMOOC. In blue, you would see the local time-stepping version of our production run and the global time-stepping version. BL means the baseline model. So this is basically the code which ran this LANDA simulation from 2014. In black, you have the Munich computer. We also ran on Shaheen in Saudi Arabia at the Khoust University, and on Cori, which is a KNL machine. On KNL, we measured a speed up of 1.3 compared to a non-KNL machine in Shaheen. However, performance tells me as a domain scientist nothing about time to solution. So here I'm showing extrapolated time to solution, which basically points out that the simulation, which would have taken around, I think, 8 days on all of SuperMOOC, was suitable to resolve in 8 hours. Okay, so the Sumatra scenario, you see, it didn't really feature that many more billion degrees of freedom. I mean, it's a large number, but this we already had in 2014. We have a lot of more time steps here, clear, because of local time stepping. Important for us is this. So 8 days on a supercomputer, we just don't get. So this kind of simulation is just unachievable for us prior to these optimizations. But 14 hours is something that is doable. So how does all of this look like? Here is a visualization of how the Sumatra earthquake is propagating along the megathrust, activating some of these splay faults and others not, and the seismic wave field radiated from that. This is just from the scales, the largest and longest dynamic rupture simulation which has been performed so far. What do we learn from that? We can replicate first-order observations and just keep this short in a very, very good manner. So here's a comparison in synthetic ground displacement with observations, and this is really what activates then a tsunami as well. We're seeing that some of these splay faults are activated and others not. This depends on the orientation. We also can have this slow rupture speed, which is an important feature of tsunamigenic earthquakes, and kind of complex pulses which are formed, which we didn't quite expect. We recently implemented more multiphysics. We are looking into the deformation of the material surrounding the fault and viscoelastic attenuation of the wave field. We are also generating high-resolution seafloor displacement data as initial condition for tsunami models, which are then coupled via the same geoinformation server that we use to initialize our models. And we are trying to constrain fault rheology and the state of stress from thermodynamical models. As an outlook, what we're really trying to do, counting on availability of exascale systems, is to go beyond these kind of forward simulations, beyond scenario-based simulations. And uncertainty quantification is a big issue. As I mentioned, we don't really know how earthquakes operate. We don't know the stresses and the strength that we need to prescribe in our simulation. So running a lot of ensemble and simulations, varying these initial conditions, would be very helpful on these scales. Another point is dynamic source inversion. So I said in the beginning that seismology is tackling to solve the inverse problem, which is mostly meaning imaging what waves saw on their way through Earth. But we can also solve an inverse problem to try to see what happened on the source. And here is a slip model for an earthquake in Turkey in 1999 from different groups. And the contours here are denoting how much each part of the rupture slipped in meters throughout the event. And you can see that they really don't agree at all. Like, they don't even agree at what happened at the hypercenter. So trying to improve this is one of the ideas we have. So running a lot of fast dynamic rupture, physics-based forward simulations, and then using Monte Carlo parallel tempering approaches to improving the inverse problem. Adjoint calculations, urgent computing, trying to come up with real-time scenarios, and ensemble simulations, not only on the scale of large earthquakes, but also, for example, to understand the seismic hazard being in all of our feet, especially in Basel, based on fracking or geothermal energy. Because there's a lot of work being done on understanding hydraulic fracturing, so how do fluids propagate through small-scale fracture networks. There's not much physics-based theory about how earthquakes propagate in these kind of networks. It's a much smaller scale, but it's geometrically very complex, and we do need some kind of statistical description of these kind of fault networks and then ensemble simulations to try and understand the related seismic hazard. Instead of conclusions, I see some laptops open here. I want to bring up a reproducibility challenge. So pushed by ACM forcing us or encouraging us to write this artifact appendix in our paper, we made a smaller setup of 3 million elements available of this whole earthquake simulation, which you can download from Zenodo. there's a whole description of how to set up that model, and you can clone our solver and try to compile it and try to run and understand your own earthquake simulation, which will be also one of the, which will be the student cluster competition for the SC conference this year. And with this, I'm finished, and I thank you for your attention. Somebody should ask me questions, I guess.
If you have any questions, it's recommended that you pull the microphone towards you and then press the mic button on your chair. Yes?
Thank you very much for the very nice talk. You mentioned something about auto-generated code. Could you say more about the framework or the tool you used?
So this has been the work of the group of Professor Michael Bader at the Technical University. And it's pre-computed generated code. So we know how our matrix-matrix multiplications look like. We have some kind of analytical pre-computed ideas about that, which we store just as maple formats. And we then generating these kind of code snippets for each of the multiplications which are involved. So you have basically to do that for every order that you want to run the simulation on, and you also have to do that in a hardware-specific way. But there's not really a platform or so related to this. It's just written manually.
Yeah. Hi. If I may ask, do you know what fraction of time your code is spending in the assembler routines as opposed to the high-level routines?
Not much. I can see if I have some additional material for that. So all of the scaling plots that we're showing and all of the measurements we're doing are including I/O and assembly. And when we're measuring also the geophysics version, we really see that the vast amount of the computing time is the matrix-matrix multiplication. I'm not sure I can fully answer your question, but from my point of view, there's no significant time spent in the assembly parts.
I'm interested in knowing what is the plasticity model that you're using. Here.
Sorry.
Got the red light. The plasticity model for the fault and for the off fault, which kind of plasticity model are you using?
On the fault, we're just solving for Coulomb failure. So basically, the typical idea of friction, pressing your hands together, you start moving them against each other, and you have some onset of failure. But the interesting part is what happens after you start slipping. And this is related to laboratory-derived empirical friction loss. For this simulation, it was linear slip weakening, the most simple case, but we do have rate and state fiction in all its variances available.
And for the off
And off fault, it's a proxy. It's not really affecting the waves. It's basically cutting off stresses with some kind of visco elastic relaxation term just to keep the cutoff more smooth. So it's also more Coulomb. Drucker-Prager plasticity, but it doesn't affect the waves, so the waves won't see the damage. So this is something in our community called damage rheology, which is much more involved.
Okay.
Yes, please.
So regarding the matrix multiplication, do you use some custom algorithm for that, or you mentioned Libex SMM?
Yes, it just calls it.
So you didn't optimize that part? I mean,
no.
Just use it out of the box? Okay.
Yes, please.
You mentioned that you need the initial state of the stresses.
Yeah.
Can you say something? How do you get that initial state?
This is a big problem. How to
right.
get that? So, yeah, we have some ideas based on inversion, geophysical inversions, or like kind of reference from aftershocks, or so, at least about the orientation of the stress field, which is very important in relation to the orientation of the fault, as we see. It's really a first-order influence on what happens throughout the earthquake. The actual amplitudes are depth-dependent, of course, and for the actual value of the magnitude of the stress, we don't really have a big handle. So we are experimenting with many different values, trying to incorporate hydrostatic effects in it, trying to include how fluid pressurizes subduction zones. And we have one approach, which I didn't include today, where we're trying to couple not only the output to tsunami models, but coupling the input to geodynamic scales, solving the thermomechanical models, or solving Navier-Stokes, and trying to which provide us with self-consistent subduction zone geometries, rheologies, and stress states. And we coupled this so far successfully in 2D, and we're working on doing that for the 3D Sumatra setup.
Yes, Marina?
Is it explicit or implicit scheme you are using?
Explicit.
Explicit.
This is why it's profitable.
And you're just only multiplying markers. You never inverse matrices.
No.
Good for you.
Yeah.
That's a relatively general property in that field of wave propagation.
Yeah.
We are lucky. any other question? Yeah. Yes, please.
So thank you for the talk. Your community does a wonderful job from sharing codes and sharing experimental data. Can you say a few words about how you're sharing simulation data? What are the expectations in your community for sharing the results of these big simulations?
Yeah, so at the moment, we don't have a community solution for how to share synthetic data. But it would be very much in the spirit of our community, which is sharing recorded seismograms all over the world. We don't have that for, like, if anybody's running such a big simulation, we are trying to make it accessible, but with a smaller model, you can reproduce some low resolution, but we don't have, like, a big database collecting synthetic models. There's a community effort called the Virtue Project, just trying to go a little bit in this direction, it's not existent.
If I can just say one word, are you referring to the project at ETH with Andres?
Yeah.
Yes, because it's a very important topic, so the community is aware of this, and we are working on this actively, but compared to other fields like atmospheric studies or climate, we are far behind, but we are trying to to catch up. Sorry. Yes, please.
What kind of precision are you using, a double, or can you use make use of mixed precision algorithms?
Double.
Okay.
Yes, please.
Hi. How did you validate the wave size?
The wave field?
The amplitude probably.
Yeah.
Size, I think.
So validation is based on all kind of geophysical data we can get a hold on. Here's shown a comparison to the deformation after the simulation. For the wave field, we don't have any recordings close to the event, which is a challenge for subduction zone earthquakes. But what we're doing is we're translating this into a kinematic source representation, so lots of point sources, and we're feeding that into a global seismic wave propagation code, for example, InstaSize, which is very simple. You can feed in point sources and which generate teleseismic data for you. This is what we're doing for that, and then comparing teleseismic data, so seismograms recorded all over the globe, with what our scenario is producing. But we're, yeah, and I think this is the way to go. We're not aiming to run this kind of model on all of the Earth, because this is just not, it's just an overkill.
Yes, please.
So you started your talk saying that there's one thing the community cannot do yet, predicting earthquakes. So what would be the big piece, you know, you could wish or need to make that possible?
We don't understand the physics of earthquake sources. So if we would, we need to understand friction also. So this is also, if you come up with an understanding of friction, especially in seismogenic conditions, which is high stresses, large scales, lots of slip, I think that would be the holy grail.
Yeah. Ultimate goal, yeah. Yes, please.
I think in one of the slides you mentioned that only 4% of the mesh surfaces have the fault details, right? Yeah. And you have around 220 million mesh.
Yeah.
Thing. Do you have any adaptive mesh refinement strategies to alleviate this problem?
Yes. We are... I mean, but, so we have to generate the mesh prior to the simulation. So it's all static. We don't do any dynamic adaptivity. When we're setting up our mesh, we're using refinement and coarsening. This is, for once, based on a CFL criterion. We have an explicit solve, which is the stability is limited by the wave speeds of each layer that we're involving. The second restriction is the dynamic rupture failure on the fault, which has an inherent length scale itself.
Yeah.
It's where stresses drop. So these two things are prescribing our static refinement strategy, so to say.
But I think for the hydrodynamic model, though, you can have the refinement strategies, dynamic refinement strategies, right?
For the tsunami models we
added.
Yes. So the tsunami simulations I showed, they have a dynamic adaptivity.
Okay.
Very simple. Just looking at the speed at the wave fronts. But this is a different equation. It's just solving a shallow water equation.
Okay.
So.
Maybe one follow-up question?
One last question, maybe.
Yes.
Okay. There we also have big systems, and normally we also find an approximated solution, as you do. But before we run the simulations, we normally sort of train or estimate our models to the data. Can you say anything about how you've trained or estimated your model and how well it sort of matches the wave height or whatever? We didn't see any of that in your presentation.
That's a manual four-fault inversion approaches. So it's running a lot of smaller scale models. Trying to fit. We do have some physics understanding. We can statically calculate closeness of failure of the fault. So we know like how to set up the stresses and the strength and kind of making these points of the fault close to failure that we need. But it's really, we don't have any learning algorithm or anything in place. It's really a PhD student looking into the model. Trying to fuse it to your physics data.
I was just wondering, you know, a big issue also for economic system is that you can do inference, right? Say how accurate our guess is. So it would be interesting also to see how accurate are your guesses on the height of the waves or all this stuff.
Yeah.
But also the kind of estimator you would use or the training algorithm would have important properties for your simulation. So that's why I would be curious to see how that was done. Basically.
So that's for us really the point that I meant with going beyond scenario-based simulation. So this uncertainty quantification. So one of the ideas we have is running a lot of forward models at once and then doing a Monte Carlo kind of parallel tempering. This is by Malcolm Sambridge. Inversion for what happens at the source, and this comes then with some range of probability density function of which models could reproduce the seismograms in a consistent way. What we know, if we don't include the physics, is this is extremely non-unique. You can basically come up with a lot of different earthquakes which don't agree at all and reproduce the data. It's a very ill-posed problem. Sorry.
Sorry, unfortunately, we're going to have to conclude even though we have many questions. One last, maybe... on the HPC side, maybe not politically correct, because we have sponsors coming from different companies. Since you tested many different architectures for this particular field, wave propagation and modeling, on what kind of technology would you bet for the future, or what do you prefer? Do you have any educated guess on this? Sorry,
we definitely. So I mean, there's obvious some decision taken that we don't go down the GPU direction. Yeah, so we did bet question. On the Intel mic technology, which was the 2014 paper where we tried to address this kind of heterogeneous structure by putting the more expensive elements on that part. This simulation was fully run on a homogeneous Haskell supercomputer, which worked really well as well. So from our point of view, we are trying to be hardware specific, and so far we've been successful with whatever we tried to put our project on. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. So let's thank Alice again.